changing the schedule. So we've actually got Sophie Cross speaking next. So Sophie is currently a PhD student at Curtin University studying reptiles, but today she's talking about some of the work she does as an honours student at UWA. And as the inaugural recipient of the Stuart Knott Memorial Scholarship for Cambridge Coast Care, so I'm sure many of you are aware Stuart was quite the champion of coastal conservation, and Cambridge Coast Care set up this scholarship in his memory. And so, Sophie, if you'd like to come up and speak to us about the work that you did there, looking at answers by indicators of restoration success. Thanks very much.
So I'll be talking about the importance of assessing animal responses to restoration and how ants can act as indicators of coastal restoration success. So this study was based on my honours project in 2014 that I did at the University of Western Australia. The southwest of Western Australia is a biodiversity hotspot. Within the Perth Coastal Dune System alone, there's, I think, roughly 150 species of native plants. And these provide food and shelter for a variety of animal species like bearded dragons, tiger snakes, and range of bird species as well. Despite being an area of very high conservation value and significant biodiversity, this area is under increasing pressures from urbanisation. Urbanisation has a massive environmental impact. Coastal regions are obviously seen as very highly desirable areas to live, and this has resulted in roughly 10% of the planet's coastal regions becoming urbanised. As you can see here, urbanisation can drastically change ecosystems from relatively intact systems with high native species composition to areas that are completely dominated by weeds and fragmented and isolated. This has a huge effect on animal communities as it can greatly restrict dispersal and gene flow, which are two critical processes for animal communities. And it can also decrease the prevalence of specialist and rare species within these systems. So this has led to the need for the immediate implementation of effective conservation and management strategies. A common method of assessing restoration success is the use of bioindicators, and ants are commonly used for this purpose. Ants make exceptionally good bioindicators because they're extremely ubiquitous and occur pretty much everywhere except for Antarctica, Greenland, and Iceland. They play a diversity of ecological roles, including seed dispersal and pollination. They are also extremely easy to sample and have well understood community dynamics. Ants are also good because they have very well known specific responses to change. So, for example, different groups will respond differently to disturbances, like in the top image is a Rhytidoponera species, and they're generally thought to be increases. So this means that if there is a disturbance to the habitat, their numbers will generally increase following this disturbance. Other species like Ocotelus, they generally have more specific needs and will most often respond negatively to environmental change. So my study basically aimed to assess whether or not vegetation quality had any effect on ant biodiversity and abundance, and also whether or not ecological connectivity had any effect on this too. So basically, were habitats that were surrounded by intact, good quality vegetation able to harbour more species diversity and abundance, or compared to habitats that might be surrounded by degraded vegetation. So we basically hope to use the results of this study to inform future conservation and management strategies on the best practices for achieving restoration success. So we had 30 study sites along the Perth Coastal Dune System, an area that you're probably all quite well familiar with. Our southernmost site was a bit north of Swanbourne Beach and just off Challenger Parade. And our study sites extended to the most northern site, which was just south of Scarborough Beach. We did have most of the study sites were concentrated within the City Beach region, as this has been an area of high high conservation focus. So these sites were split up into various quality vegetation, which included intact vegetation, degraded and rehabilitated sites. To give you an indication of the type of type of qualities that we were using, we had completely degraded sites which had basically no native vegetation left, areas of high weed concentration and also bare ground patches. We then had degraded sites which were a little bit better than the completely degraded sites, but still had massive amounts of weed invasion and very minimal native species coverage. Rehabilitated sites were areas that were starting to approximate those of intact sites, so they had increased native species but still had a bit of weed invasion as well. And then lastly we had the intact sites, which were fairly good quality and had very minimal weed invasions and predominantly native species. So to trap ants we use a method called pitfall trapping, which are basically these small plastic containers. They get dug into the ground so that the surrounding soil is level with the lip of the container, and then they're part filled with ethylene glycol. This is a colourless, odourless liquid which doesn't attract the ants, and it also doesn't evaporate. So that was handy because we had to set them for a period of 4 days at a time. So within each of our 30 sites, we set 20 of these traps in a 5x4 trapping grid, and this was repeated over autumn, winter and spring. This led to a total of 1,800 traps being set over the course of our study, which led to the rather interesting task of ant identification. This was a frustrating task, admittedly, because every single ant that we trapped had to be individually pinned and identified. And we trapped 5,685 ants. So there was quite a good diversity. We ended up getting 38 species from 18 genera. And not only because of the sheer numbers that we were trapping, there were quite a few factors which made this process make me go slightly insane. The first being the huge range in sizes that we trapped. So we were trapping species probably up to about a centimetre long, which they were fine, they were nice and easy. But then I had species that were only 1 millimetre long, and trying to get them onto a tiny piece of card so that you don't break off their legs and they're all nicely presented for identification is quite a difficult task. Then we had the added bonus of a lot of ants looking quite similar. Two of our groups caused me endless frustration. It's pretty much the only factor that was different between these two was a single hair on, above their mandible. So in one of the species they had an elongated hair which is extended basically the middle of their above the mandible, and the other species didn't have this. So the other group. So if during the trapping process this hair had actually somehow been snapped off, it was very difficult. And then I came across something that I had never heard of before, ant mimicking wasps. So if you thought, you know, trying to identify the ants was a hard enough experience, if you've never heard of these and you don't know they exist, kind of spend the while going through your identification keys wondering why you're not getting anything. Ant mimicking wasps, as you can see, look pretty similar to ants. But the main differences are that the length of their first segment on the antennae is quite a lot smaller, and they also have quite large compound eyes. So when this was pointed out to me, it was a lot easier. So we had some pretty fantastic results. We ended up finding a very strong correlation, a positive correlation between ant diversity and vegetation quality. So basically sites of better quality were exhibiting higher diversities. We also found that the sites that had greater ecological connectivity and so were surrounded by better quality vegetation also harbored higher diversities of ants. So this is fantastic news for all those planting efforts because it means the restoration is actually working. Our main finding was that there was no significant difference between the ant communities within intact sites and those in restored areas. So that's fantastic news. Another interesting thing was that we only actually ended up finding two species of invasive ants. This was on the top image, which was Tetramorium similimum, and the bottom image, which is Phytolae megacephala. The Phytolae you probably have already seen it around quite a lot, because this is the species that generally invades urban areas, and you probably find it in your own homes, and you probably know it's also very difficult to get rid of. So this species is more commonly referred to as the coastal brown ant, or the big-headed ant. And it's a particularly bad one because it will actively predate on other native ant species as well as invertebrates until it eventually just dominates the landscape. So Phytolae has been nominated as being among the top 100 world's worst invaders. And this is a list that not only encompasses invertebrate species, but vertebrates and plants as well. Another interesting finding for this study was that we found that habitat patches that were in closest proximity to urban areas were 40% more likely to have an invasive species within that patch. And that has interesting conservation implications because it means that the general public are also able to help stop the spread of this, because if it's stopped at the source, then they're less likely to spread to native areas. So interestingly, most of the invasive ants were found in degraded areas, and there were very few numbers in intact and restoration sites. So that's also good news for restoration, indicating that they're not actually spreading to those sites that are being restored. Also, 75% of the Phytolae megacephala that we found occurred within one single plot along the dunes. This was our most degraded plot, and it was also the site in closest proximity to urban development, which was actually just off Challenger Parade. So that again suggests the need for conservation efforts to be focused on areas that are in close proximity to urban development, and also on increasing that quality to prevent further spread. So basically we found that there are two main factors in restoration success of these coastal dunes. The first is on connecting natural areas, so that there is more ecological connectivity and more chance of increasing your species diversity. And the second is on stopping the invasive spread, as invasive ants are highly detrimental for native species. So essentially, we found that restoration was successful when the restored sites were starting to emulate intact sites. And most importantly, we found that current restoration is actually working.
Thanks very much, Sophie. Any questions?
Can you elaborate on your, your trapping the ants in with the ethylene glycol? What was the glycol for?
The ethylene glycol.
Yes.
It basically acts as a preservative, so the ants will pretty much drink it and then die, happy death because they're drunk, and it just preserves them for long enough that I can actually wash them off and ID them for later.
So they just fall into the jar because it's a.
Yeah, they just continue across the landscape and basically fall in.
Hi. I just wanted to know the difference between the numbers of invasive between degraded and restored sites and intact. Do you have any rationale as to why? Was there high levels of predation in the intact or restored? What's the balance there?
It seems to be quite a significant effect of the vegetation quality, in that the restored sites, on the most part, were actually starting to resemble those intact sites, whereas the degraded sites had very little native vegetation, and probably it could be that the increased percentage of bare ground coverage was also facilitating that spread that were moving across the landscapes easier. I think that the main effect was that the vegetation was help preventing the spread.
There's not much natural competition from other species, native species?
I'm not too sure about the actual predation within the system. There was obvious dominances between different ant groups within various parts of the system, but I wouldn't be too sure on the actual predation.
Is it possible, Sophie, to project to other species, so like other insects, birds, mammals, reptiles, the same story, that in restored areas you're likely to find a more abundant populations of native animals?
Yes, so because ants can be great indicators of restoration success, as their communities were starting to emulate intact sites, it's highly likely that other faunal groups are probably going along the same sorts of lines. We did also look into birds at the study, but we mainly focused on ants for the actual publication. And the birds, on the most part, were showing similar trends.
One more question, yeah.
And Sophie, I'm sort of familiar that ants will distribute acacia cyclops seeds, they're after the red arrow. Are there any other species that you're aware of, plant species, that ants will commonly distribute their seeds?
I'm fairly sure there are a number of species that ants will distribute. I'm not entirely as well known on the plant side of things, but I think that there have been a number of studies about seed dispersal in ants. I'm just not overly sure on the actual plant species that they are carrying.
Yep, one more question, we'll break for lunch.
I might have missed it, Sophie, but in your pit traps, did you find that there was usually only one species, or you could have dozens of species? Was there a colonisation?
It varied quite a lot. Some traps we were finding maybe just even one individual. Other traps we had probably anywhere between 10 and 20 species in. In the degraded sites, you find pretty much just one or two individuals, and they're usually from the same species. And then intact sites, usually a lot more. And then you get the instances where I trapped what looked like a single colony within one of my traps, ended up with like 600 individuals of the same species. So it varied quite a lot. But yeah, there was definitely differences.
One species doesn't appear to exclude another.
Sometimes it can have an effect. Certain species found, like the Iridromomax, were, I think, more abundant within landscapes that were slightly more open, and they tended to be more dominant within those systems. And so those ones definitely had a higher proportion of those species. But yeah, very variable.
Okay, so it is lunchtime, everyone's favourite of the day, I'm sure. So about 30 minutes for lunch, and so thanks again for all our speakers, and then if we just have Andrew and John come back up and we can pass over their bottle of wine, it's our sign of appreciation. So
thanks, Dave.